2019, and it's on page 878 in your handout. The future glory of the temple. In the second year of King Darius, in the seventh month, on the 21st day of the month, the word of the Lord came by the prophet Haggai, saying, "Speak now to Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, son of Jehozadak, the high priest, and to the remnant of the people, and said, Who is left among you that saw this house in its former glory? How does it look to you now? Is it not in your sight as nothing? Yet now take care, courage, O Zerubbabel, says the Lord. Take courage, O Joshua, son of Jehozadak, the high priest. Take courage, all you people of the land, says the Lord. Work, for I am with you, says the Lord of hosts, according to the promise that I made you when you came out of Egypt. My spirit abides among you. Do not fear. For thus says the Lord of hosts, once again, in a little while, I will shake the heavens and the earth, and the sea and the dry land, and I will shake all the nations, so that the nature, that treasure of all nations shall come, and I will fill this house with splendor, says the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine, and the gold is mine, says the Lord of hosts. The latter splendor of this house shall be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. And in this place I will give prosperity, says the Lord of hosts. On the 24th day of the ninth month, in the second year of Darius, the word of the Lord came by the prophet Haggai, saying, Thus says the Lord of hosts, Seek the priests for ruling. If no one carries consecrated meat in the fold of one's garment, and with the fold touches bread, or stew, or wine, or oil, or any kind of food, does it become holy? The priest answered, No. Then Haggai said, If one who is unclean by contact with a dead body touches any of these, does it become unclean? The priest answered, Yes, it becomes unclean. Haggai then said, So it is with this people and with this nation before me, says the Lord, and so with every work of their hands. And what they offer there is unclean. But now consider, what will come to pass from this day on? Before a stone was placed upon a stone of the Lord's temple, how did you fare? When one came to a heap of 20 measures, there were but 10. When one came to the wine vat to draw 50 measures, there were but 20. I struck you and all the products of your toil with blight and mildew and hail. Yet you did not return to me, says the Lord. Consider from this day on, from the 24th day of the ninth month, since the day that the foundation of the Lord's temple was laid, consider, is there any seed left in the barn? Do the vine, the fig tree, the pomegranate, and the olive tree still yield nothing? From this day on, I will bless you. And the epistle reading is from 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5, and 13 to 17, and it's on page 206. As to the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, our being gathered together to him, we beg you, brothers and sisters, not to be quickly shaken in mind or alarmed, either by spirit or by the word or by letter, as though from us, to the effect that the day of the Lord is already here. Let no one deceive you in any way, for that day will not come unless the rebellion comes first, and the lawless one is revealed, the one destined for destruction. He opposes and exalts him above every so-called god or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, declaring himself to be God. Do you not remember that I told you these things when I was still with you? But we must also give thanks to God for you, brothers and sisters, beloved by the Lord, because God chose you as the first fruits for salvation, through sanctification by the Spirit, and through belief in the truth. For this purpose he called you through our proclamation of the good news, so that you may obtain the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. So then, brothers and sisters, stand firm and hold fast to the traditions that you were taught by us, either by word of mouth or by our letter. And the gospel reading is Luke 20, verses 27 through 38 on page 84. Some Sadducees, those who say there is no resurrection, came to him and asked him a question. Teacher, Moses wrote for us that if a man's brother dies, leaving a wife but no children, the man shall marry the widow and raise up children for his brother. Now there were seven brothers. The first married and died childless, and then the second, and the third married her, and so in the same way all seven died childless. Finally, the woman also died. In the resurrection, therefore, whose wife will be the woman be? For the seven had married her. Jesus said to them, those who belong to this age marry and are given in marriage, but those who are considered worthy of a place in that age and in the resurrection from the dead neither marry nor are given in marriage. Indeed, they cannot die anymore, because they are like angels and are children of God, and being children of resurrection. And the fact that the dead are raised, Moses himself showed in the story about the bush, where he speaks of the Lord as the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Now he is God, not of the dead, but of the living, for to him all of them are one.
Would you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Grace to you and peace from God, our Heavenly Father, and his blessed Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. I was saying to Tim Swanson last night that the preaching task today is onerous in the sense that the situation before us is such that on the one hand, we traditionally speak about stewardship commitment on this Sunday before we fill out our pledge cards. And at the same time, it is quite apparent that there are larger looming issues for our nation, as we soon go to the polls and cast our ballots for the candidates of our choice. Are you ready for the election to be over?
Yes.
As we say in the South, that'll preach. I think we have all been dismayed by this particular election cycle. It has been a time of accusation. It has been a time of the disclosure of the most acute foibles. It has been a time of research and discovery and allegation and investigation. And everywhere we turn, as we turn on our TVs, we are bombarded by the most pathetic kind of statements about each and every candidate, all the way down the line. My word, my word. As you come to the pulpit on a day like this, where do you turn? What does the Scripture have to say to us? Well, thanks be to God, the Scripture has a lot to say to us. And the very first point that I wish to make in preaching on this particular Sunday is that as we come to the Word of God, let us remember that the Word of God is present at all times in the church. The Word of God is present and is spoken into human history at definite times and places. And part of the preaching task is to rediscover the application of those times and places in the present time and in the present place. So today I preach on a portion of Scripture someday of stewardship commitment and preparation of the people of God who, like the whole people of our nation, sometimes feel so afraid in this election cycle, who are dismayed by the implications for finance and for the economy, who are beaten down by the allegations and the pure nastiness of this election cycle. Well, turn to Haggai. To turn to Haggai, who was a prophet of the Lord. Haggai, of whom very little is known. Haggai, who was appointed to be the prophet of the Lord for simply 5 months' cycle. Haggai, that small Old Testament prophecy that was written around 520 B.C. Maybe if we go back, way back to the prophet Haggai, we can hear the word of the Lord that instructs us as God's people. God's people in a culture of fear instructs us how we shall be and what we shall do. Now, the historic context of Haggai was, you will recall, the Babylonian captivity. Most of the people of Israel were taken away into Babylonian servitude. There was simply a very small remnant that remained in Jerusalem. They weren't the finest, the best educated. They weren't the upper class. They were kind of the dregs of the dregs of Israeli society. After a long period of captivity, after a long time, in 538 B.C., Cyrus, the emperor, gave an edict that allowed some of these captive Jews to return to their homeland. And so they came back. Sometimes the brightest and the best. Some with some reasonable treasure. But most of them still desperately poor, joining with the survivors, the remnants that remained, who were even abundantly more poor. In the course of time, Cyrus passed away, and a new emperor emerged. His name was Darius I. Upon taking the emperorship, the crown, Darius I faced a national calamity. One-third of the empire rose up against him. One-third rebelled against him, and it was questionable whether he would indeed succeed as the emperor. And in a time of acute battle, in a time when everything about the culture and the politics were unsettled, finally Darius struck a victory. Darius was secure. Darius had solidified his empire. Darius had identified and squashed those who had revolted. And everything was fairly okay. It was fairly okay. And so Darius, rewarding people of the two-thirds who were supportive of him, who didn't cause him a trouble, who didn't stir things up, he looked for ways to reward and acknowledge them. For the Jews, but now in 16 years in Jerusalem, Darius gave permission that they could proceed with rebuilding the temple, permission to reestablish the institution of their Jewish faith. Up until this time, they had just been a sliver of the former kingdom. Up until this time, they lived in the squalor of Jerusalem that had been torn down in the Babylonian captivity time. Up until this time, they were subjugated to being a province under the direction of the Samaritans, which explains a lot, doesn't it, when you get to your New Testament. But now they were told, you may rebuild your temple. Now, wouldn't you think that they would be overjoyed by this news? Wouldn't you think that they would be celebrating the fact that the emperor said that they could reestablish the temple of Jerusalem, that they could go back and have some congregate, there was a resentment towards Zerubbabel and Joshua, the grandchildren of the high priest and the ruler who had led off into Babylonian captivity and had now returned. In the scripture, it talks about some of us lived in paneled houses. Well, what they're saying is, Joshua, Zerubbabel, who weren't here through the hard times, well, they came back with some means, and their real estate was reasonably nice compared to the rest of us. I mean, these were poor folk. These were people who were afraid of the climate. These were people who had been beaten down. These were people most miserable and sad and confused and unsettled. And God sends them a prophet named Haggai. The name Haggai means festival. I mean, that's just about all we know, is that this prophet of the Lord who served for 5 months, his name is festival. It means celebrate. And Haggai comes onto the scene with the prophecy of the Lord. And the prophecy insists that the people rise on up, that the people get on up, and get about rebuilding the temple. These poor people, these desperate people, these resistant people, these confused people, these people who are so afraid of just about everything and have been pushed down, are told by God, you rise up and build the temple of the Lord. Still, there were some who remembered the old temple in their glory. Now, that's 67 years ago. But God had sustained and had some of the people still who were in Jerusalem at this time. They remembered what the glory of the temple was. They remembered Solomon's temple. They remembered happier days. They remembered the good times before the fall of Jerusalem. And as they thought about what they had to work with their poverty, with their simple means, they were in despair. I mean, why even bother, they thought? Why even bother to go from a cathedral to a house church on Main Street? After all, the Ark of the Covenant was gone. The mercy seat of God was gone. The cherubim. Oh, we remember the cherubim. Gone. The Urim and the Thummim. Gone. Tablets of stone. Gone. The pot of manna. Gone. Aaron's rod. Gone. The eternal fire. Gone. What would this new temple have to celebrate? What would it look like? How could anything good reemerge? How do you go from a cathedral to a storefront? And God spoke to the prophet to remind the people. God spoke to the prophet, through the prophet, to remind us that the God who is the God of the past, the God who is the God of the present, the God who is the God of our future filled the temple with glory. And God himself can, yet in unimagined and unknown ways, in new and exciting ways, despite the prevalent situation that we may see thrust upon us, the limitations, the fears, the desperation, the confusion, the division. God, who filled the temple with glory, can still fill this temple with glory in unimagined ways. And so the prophet Haggai gives the people this instruction. This instruction for unsettled times. This instruction for times of division. This instruction for times of feeling beaten down in the culture. Instruction for times when you Be strong. Joshua, be strong. People of Israel, be strong. Be strong, my people, for I am with you. And what more do you need than that? Be strong in the wafting weave of political intrigue. Be strong when we seem to be divided and cast up. Be strong when we're unsettled and unsure of which way to go. Be strong when we have to take our little and trust God to turn it into a lot. Be strong, for our God is with us in every situation and condition. Second, the prophet says, remember what defilement is. Things don't defile things. Only people defile things. So stop being defiled. Stop being around dead things. Stop committing yourself into contact with things that are atrocious and destructive. Avoid defilement. And then also, most of all, remember that you're living in a state of grace because of the mercy of God who is with you. The prophet says, in every situation, give careful thought. When the time comes to fill out that pledge card, give careful thought. When you go on down to wherever you cast the ballot, give careful thought. The prophet says, is there any seed left in the barn? That's the 19th verse. It's a beauty. I mean, you struggle. Where's that coming from? What's God talking about through the barn? What do you mean, is there any seed in the barn? You just told us that everything we tried to plant didn't work out, so there's no seed to be recovered for the next harvest. Oh, there's only little seed in the barn. There's only a minutia of seed. My gosh, maybe this is where Jesus got that mustard seed concept from. And then God says, yes. But I am with you. There may be very little seed in our nation's barn. There may be very little seed in our denomination's barn. There may be little seed in our congregation's barn. But again, the point is made. God is with God's people. And so we can do a lot with a little. God is with God's people. And there is enough. And then this entire prophecy, this section of prophecy that we read today, it concludes. And I better conclude because it's 11 o'clock. My word! God simply says, don't forget. I will bless you. I want you, as God's people, living in the real world in which we find ourselves, to remember the promise of God, I will bless you. To remember the instruction of the prophet, be strong. To stay away from defiling things.